fansupermart.com.
What are some of the key macroeconomic challenges in Asia?
The key macroeconomic challenges in Asia for the coming years, or in the next 1 to 2 years that we foresee, I think there are a couple. The major one would clearly be if there's policy normalization in the developed markets, where the US central bank or the UK central bank start to raise interest rates. If that happens, well, on the one hand, it'll be good because it means that the recovery in the developed markets are stronger. But in that transition period, we could see some challenges for Asia and emerging markets because the rising interest rates in the developed markets could lead to fund outflows. So that's, I think, the main challenge. The second challenge for us here in Asia is, of course, China. China has embarked on a series of reforms which will result in slower growth in China. While slower growth in China in and of itself is not necessarily a bad thing, but I think China has to maintain a certain level of growth such that the economy does not slow down too much and does not lead to a crisis of any sort. Because if China goes through a crisis, given China's size in the global economy today, the implications for the rest of Asia could be very significant.
What is your outlook on Asia in the next 1 to 2 years?
We've always been long-term positive on Asia. Of course, Asia will go through its ups and downs because of fund flows, because of economic policies or monetary policies in the other parts of the world, which could lead to fund inflows or fund outflows. But to us, these are the blips, you know, the typical sort of volatility that anyone faces investing in Asia. But over the longer term, especially in certain regions of Asia, we maintain a very positive stance. And this is largely driven to the key ingredients that we see present in a lot of the countries in Asia. And some of these key ingredients which leads us to be positive is demographics. Asia, especially some of the ASEAN countries, have got a very young population, which will, you know, normally leads to sustainable long-term growth, because a younger population inevitably will lead to more urbanization, more employment, higher productivity, and more consumption. So we like Asia from a longer-term perspective, irrespective of the ebbs and flows of capital in the short term, which we'll see.
Income theme funds have been popular among investors. What is your outlook on Asian stocks that offer growing dividend yields, and what are the fundamental factors behind this trend?
Income-seeking type investments, I think it's here to stay for a long time. And similarly to investing in Asia or emerging markets, they tend to be subject to short-term fluctuations of volatility depending on the interest rate cycle. So if you look at income theme style investing or dividend investing, it did very well from 2010, 2011, 2012, midway through 2013, when there was fears that the US Federal Reserve would raise interest rates. We saw quite a sharp correction in dividend stocks or emerging market bonds or in bonds. Since the second quarter of this year, we've seen a resumption of interest into income type investments because investors are a lot more comfortable today that the major central banks in the world will keep interest rates lower for longer. So we've seen a resumption of interest into this theme. There will be, you know, when the time comes where central banks may have to raise interest rates, yes, perhaps we could see a lessening of interest in this theme. But once again, for a longer term perspective, we strongly believe in dividend yield investments, especially in those companies that have growing dividend yields. Because growing dividend yields means that the business is still growing and they are able to pay higher and higher dividends as their business grows. That's one point. The second point why we believe longer term this theme would stay with us is because if you look at the global population today, yes, emerging markets and ASEAN, you've got young demographics, young population, but the majority of the world is going through an aging process. And as you know, people who approach retirement age or people who, you know, once they're past 45, 50, they start thinking about retirement. And for them, in terms of their investments and retirement planning, they tend to seek income. And that's where bonds or dividend stocks fulfills that role for them.
Apart from income team, are there any sectors or industries that are expected to outperform?
I think there are a few sectors that we like, depending on which countries. For example, in Malaysia and Indonesia, we like the oil and gas sectors. Indonesia as well, we like the infrastructure theme, because and that applies for India as well, because with the new governments in place, and Indonesia presumably the new leader would be in place soon, I think the government's focus on infrastructure spending would be very strong, and that's why we like those themes in those countries. So oil and gas is one, infrastructure spending is one, and over the medium to long term for Asia, or especially in ASEAN, domestic consumption is a theme that we continue to like.
Conversely, are there any sectors or industries that you have the least conviction in?
I think some of the sectors that we do not favour would be those where there's policy headwinds. So one example would be Chinese property companies or the property sector in China, because we know that as of now, the Chinese government is trying to cool down the property sector. They do not want prices to rise too quickly, and that explains why the Chinese property stocks have not done well. The other sector that we do not really favour would be the hard commodity sector. So hard commodities would mean your iron or coal, because while these commodities did very well when China went through its huge infrastructure boom, I think moving forward, China's growth would no longer be driven by fixed asset investments, and therefore commodities such as this are likely to see that kind of super cycle that we saw in 2008-2009 anymore. So that is one sector we don't like. A couple of other sectors that we don't like would be petrochemicals, for example, because there's a lot of supply coming on stream. Second one would be China financials. I think that's, again, a sector that we think, because there's a lot of uncertainty, we're not able to pinpoint exactly the conditions of the books of Chinese banks. So that's a sector we prefer to avoid for now.